So, gentlemen, good morning to all of you. The topic for today is centrifugal pumps. And of course, I have prepared it keeping in mind about our MUA examinations also. And I'm not going to look at the basics too much. And the focus is going to be more on performance curves. What do we understand? We are talking about Q curves. We say people call it performance. People call it characteristic curves or QH curves. Or we have a curve for NPSH and we have a curve for efficiency. We have a curve for horsepower. So for a centrifugal pump, let us understand the basics. So that's what this session is all about. And if you remember last class, I have not completed air conditioning. Air conditioning, the last part of it, summer cycle as well as winter cycle is still pending. And also about legionnaire bacteria. So at the end of the session, I'll just probably allot about 10 minutes to complete that air conditioning features, whatever is left out in my last session. So as of now, we will just start with this session. And I request you to please interact at any point of time. You can stop me. You can ask me questions. And I'll be too glad to answer your questions. If you put it in the chat, our moderator will just read it out later. Or you can just, any point of time, you can ask the questions. Okay. Now, with this, let me just move on. Now, this 1 hour, till 11 o'clock, I'm going to be with you. And this 1 hour, I feel, is too short to talk about a centrifugal pump, looking at all the features. Now, basically, as I have said, this session, our focus is going to be basically understand the basic performance curves and things like that. And the maintenance part of it, probably I may not be able to cover in this session because the time is too short. So if you just run through the objectives, learning objectives of this particular session, you can see basic, let us understand the pump theory. Pump theory, what I mean is understanding the curves and running two pumps in parallel, two pumps in series. Of course, tanker people, you all understand, you know, we run cargo pumps in parallel and we sometimes have a booster pump on the deck which runs in series with our main pump. So let's understand the parallel pumping of centrifugal pumps. And at that point of time, what happens to the flow rate and to what effect it has on the head? So what is the difference between the main parallel running as well as in running in series? So that part of it we are going to see. Apart from that, let us understand this NPSH, net positive suction head. We know that we have two types. One is what we say required and the other one is available. And what is the difference? And all of us, basically, we know that the available NPSH has to be more than the required. But still, the concept of NPSH, my interaction with students, both in HIMT classroom, as well as when I go to MMD for orals, I feel that it is not properly understood. Maybe I will have a clarity here today. And of course, cavitation. And the performance, eductor performance, where all we use eductors on board the ship. Apart from that, back pressure curve or what people call shore curve or call resistance curve. Let's see what it is. And apart from that, on board tankers, we have cargo pumps, oil tankers, chemical tankers and gas tankers. I briefly just touched that type of pumps also. Like, for example, in chemical tankers, we have Framo pumps. We have in gas tankers, we have electrically driven diesel pumps. So, I will just, we'll have a brief discussion on those type of cargo pumps on all types of tankers also. So, let's move on next. So, basically, why do we use centrifugal pumps? So, I have just listed the advantages. We say it's very compact. Look at VLCC. very large crude oil carrier. We have three cargo pumps running, and each cargo pump, we talk about 4,000, 5,000 cubic meter per hour. That means in 1 hour, if three pumps run, say about 15,000 cubics. And of course, how much time we need to complete, say in about, say, 20 hours, how much we would have discharged. So the centrifugal pumps, what we have on board ships of that capacity, of that type of ships, the capacity of centrifugal pumps are too large, but then it's very compact. Large volumes are handled, steady output, and maintenance is not that difficult. And from noise level, we say it's silent running pump, unless you have any issue. Suppose if there is a problem with alignment, or in case of bearing issues, or any issues with your casing ring, or rotating part touching somewhere in the stationary, that's different. That's a mechanical damage. So the low to medium viscous fluid is not an issue here. Like, for example, discharging, like on board the ships in the engine room, we say we have our seawater pumps, we have our freshwater pumps, jacket cooling pumps, and we have pumps for lube oil, all our centrifugal pumps. So low viscous is not an issue, but then high viscous, yes, high viscous is an issue. The centrifugal pump may not be suitable if the oil is too thick. I think practically we have seen it in the engine room. Suppose if your bunker tank is not properly treated, properly heated, then probably if the heating coil of your bunker tank is not working, or some of them are not working, then you find when your fuel oil transfer pump, taking fuel oil from your bunker tanks to your fuel oil settling tanks, you will find the pump will literally cry. It will just make, because it's not able to just to pull, you know. So high viscous, it's not the pump. You need to look it for maybe double helical screw pump, maybe some sort of type of positive displacement pump. And can manage low to medium head is not issue. But if it is going to be a very high head requirement, suppose you need to have maybe two-stage or three-stage type of pumps. So basically, if you just look at the main advantages for this pump, this is how I have listed. Apart from that, what are the disadvantages? Advantages are too many, you know. So that's why you see, just to think about, on board the ships, everywhere we have centrifugal pump. Where all we have positive displacement? Okay, maybe machinery space, bilge water related, bilge pump, yes, it is a reciprocating pump, or what we call up and down pump. And some places we have screw pumps and your gear pumps. Of course, hydraulic pumps we have, variable displacement pumps. Apart from that, you will find most of the duties on board the ship, whether it is engine room or anywhere, you know, we always depend upon centrifugal pumps. So let's look at the disadvantages. As I have said earlier, high viscous fluids means there's going to be a problem. Requires priming, yes. So unless otherwise the pump is primed, priming means what? Filling up the pump casing and the inlet line full of water. Or it's not only water, any liquid. Unless otherwise you do priming, the centrifugal pump is not going to work. Why? You see the third point. Cannot handle air or vapor. Why? Why it's not able to handle? We always say, the bilge pump in the engine room is always positive displacement. That means you are reciprocating pump. Why we don't use centrifugal pump? Now here it is written, cannot handle air or vapor. I just want any one of my young friends, participants there, students, can you give me an answer to this? Why centrifugal pump cannot handle air? Who can tell me? Hello? Hello, are you able to hear me?
Because the centrifugal pump works by throwing the liquid or fluid out of the casing.
Yes, the centrifugal pump is throwing the liquid from the eye of the impeller towards the periphery. Okay, that's what is happening. Okay, but that doesn't answer this question. But you are coming closer. Can you tell me why, when it can handle liquid, why it cannot handle vapor?
Because of the clearances, sir.
Because of
clearances.
You mean to say that clearance
between density
I think somebody else is coming. Your name and then answer me. I think let it be an interactive session, man. Don't be too serious. Be friendly.
So, Suranjan, yes. The specific gravity difference between the liquid and air is quite large. The water can experience the churning effect, which is created by the impeller, where the air cannot exert the churning effect.
Churning effect is churning effect will happen only when you close the delivery valve fully and keep running the pump, no? Only that time we call it churning, you know, because there is no liquid flow. Okay, now you just look at this.
It is due to the mass flow, the density mass flow.
Yes. Now you are coming closer. See, basically, why do we call it a centrifugal pump, gentlemen? Centrifugal pump, we call it because, you know, the pump work basically, the principle is, you know, the basic concept here is the centrifugal force. So, what is centrifugal force? If you just look back, probably in our, I think, 10th class or 12th class, we studied about centrifugal force. And we always say centrifugal force is equal to M omega squared R.
Yes,
am I right? So, what is M? As you rightly said, M is mass. Omega is what? Angular velocity. So, angular velocity, when a centrifugal pump is running, you know, you relate it to the RPM. Angular velocity is nothing but your RPM. M omega squared R. Now, what is that R? R relates to, R is what? Radius of what? Impeller,
sir.
Yes. So, you have impeller radius is one and angular velocity or the pump RPM. Now, let us assume the centrifugal pump is running at the same RPM. Like, for example, most of our engine room pumps are running at the same RPM. And we don't, vary the speed. Okay, we vary the speed for some of the centrifugal pump. Now, look at our COPs on tankers. We have a turbine, COPT, and very fine tuning. We increase this RPM, decrease the RPM. We do all that. But then, what about our fire and GS pump? What about our ballast pump? What about our seawater pump? So, these type of pumps, you know, they run at the same RPM. So, your RPM angular velocity is fixed. I'm looking back at the formula. Centrifugal force is equal to M omega squared R. Now, R is fixed. It's not going to change. Omega is not going to change as long as you don't change the RPM. Then we can say centrifugal force is proportional to the mass of the fluid. So, now compare the mass of liquid to the mass of vapor or mass of air. So, if you just look at mass of air or mass of vapor is very less, you know, your liquid mass is going to be many, many fold higher, dense. So, what is happening when centrifugal pump is running? If there is a liquid there or if there is water or oil, from the eye of the impeller, it is just thrown to the periphery so that it enters into the volute casing and then it further travels on. Whereas in the case of air or vapor, what happens? It gets trapped. This is what we say, airlock. I think engineers, we are very familiar with this term. In the engine room, what do we say? The pump, like, have you seen sometimes your emergency fire pump? The emergency fire pump probably due for a survey. Your SEQ survey is due and then you have done all preparation. Everything is okay. But then very often what happens when the surveyor is there at that particular time, you know, the pump will not take suction. Pump, pump is running, but the pump is not taking suction. Sometimes we call it airlock. So, in case if there is any air or any, due to the low pressure at the eye of the impeller, in case if you... Now, what do we say? Centrifugal pumping, what do we say? Your inlet valve has to be fully open. Don't throttle the suction valve. Keep it fully open. And when you start the pump, okay, start with the discharge valve closed. After starting at a lower RPM, then slowly, if you can vary the RPM, this is what we do for our COPs on tankers. So, suction valve, we don't touch, you know, we don't throttle, we keep the valve fully open. We don't want to take a chance, any drop in pressure at the eye of the impeller, you know. And we all know, any drop, if it happens, if that happens to be below the vapor pressure of that particular fluid, which is being treated by the pump, then what will happen?
Cavitation will take place.
Then it will form vapors. Once it forms vapor, then we are going to find it very difficult. So, now let us just look at it. Basically, the mass of the fluid, that makes a mat. So, that is why it cannot handle air or vapor and it requires priming. Of course, cavitation is also, of course, related to it. And very high heads is not a problem. I mean, it is a problem where low or medium head is not a problem. So, that's why sometimes we have multi-stage pump, you know, two-stage or three-stage. Now, from the disadvantages, now, this is the basic of centrifugal pump. I need not explain much, you know. We have two different types and most of the pumps in the engine room on board, what we have is this type of volute casing. Now, gentlemen, I just want you to understand in volute casing what is happening. Here at the eye of the impeller, the liquid is being drawn because of the low pressure. Something pushes the liquid to the eye of the impeller. And when the impeller runs, you know, when the impeller rotates, it just adds kinetic energy. You know, that's what we say in pump theory. So what happened? It is thrown to the periphery. In the periphery, if you just see here, slowly, you can say the volume keeps on increasing. So what we say that your energy is being converted from velocity energy to kinetic energy to pressure energy. That's what is happening. And of course, this is a very, very simple animation you can see on the screen now. Can you see? Hello, can you see?
Yes, sir.
We can see. That animation, can you see? There's something rotating there?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Is it rotating in the right direction or wrong direction?
Right direction, sir.
Right direction. Yes. So this is how, see, very often, even when we have issues with any of the pumps in the engine room, the one of the first thing what we need to do is we always start from the fundamentals, from the basics. First thing you just check. You know, I have an experience in one of my ships when I was sailing as a chief engineer. For a long time, you know, a particular pump was giving issues, you know, it was not developing pressure and all that. Then finally, it was such a simple thing. What has happened earlier in one of the overhauls when the pump was dismantled and reassembled? The Bhatti Sahab has given connections wrong so that the pump was rotating in the wrong direction. So that is why you will find changing the direction of rotation will just make the pump to run, or you will find your pump pressure is not getting developed. So now here I just want to see your volute casing. Now let me just explain this volute casing. For that, we need to look at the eductor. So, gentlemen, tell me, where all we use eductors? Do we use it in freshwater
generator?
Yes, in freshwater generator, all of you know, we have air ejector, we have brain ejector. Okay, apart from that, how will you pump out bilges from the chain locker, gentlemen?
Sir, by using eductor.
And likewise, we also have one steering flood bilge is pumping out sometimes, you will find. And of course, in tankers, we have for skipping. Of course, even in
ballast eductor, sir.
Yeah, everywhere. I think, you know, as you are aware, this is a very, very fundamental, you know, eductor diagram, which all of us, we understand. But one thing I just want, you know, because sometimes the questions, people give me wrong answers. Just to look at this. Now, position number one. Now, just look at the diagram on the left, where point number one, it is written V1, P1, A1, and you know, V is the velocity and P is the pressure. Now, this is what we call venturi, right? At the neck, throat, you can call it throat. Now, what happens at throat? The pressure, like P2, and here it is P1, and here it is P2. Now, the P2 and P1, what is the relationship? Which is higher and which is lower?
P2 is lower.
Yes, P2 has to be lower.
Yes,
so this is what is happening. This nozzle, what you are looking at on the left, this is what we call convergent, divergent nozzle. Convergent, convergent. So your P2 is less than P1. Likewise, divergent. Then in the divergent part, so what is happening here in this particular point? So when you are going from here to here like this, what is happening? What happens to the pressure? P2. Now the P2 is slowly increasing to P1. Now the volume here keeps on increasing. Now this is what is happening. So now you just see, now this part what you see, now this is what your volute casing is all about. So the volute casing of a centrifugal pump, if you just look, it has been very specifically made this way, here like this. Now what is happening here? Now the liquid is slowly flowing all the way like this. So when it flows like this, what is happening? The volume keeps on increasing. Now that's what it is here. So the kinetic energy is converted to pressure energy. So the basically the eductor principle we know, and the eductor, the only advantage in eductor is what? Does it have any moving part like a centrifugal pump, impeller rotating?
No.
Nothing there.
No, sir.
We are using it for all these duties. I think you have already listed them already. Vacuum toilets, yes, we are using. And of course, in your fire extinguishing system, we use it in the foam applicator.
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay, and chain locker, boson store. Okay, now let's move on. Now, this is the basic, you see your centrifugal pump and you see this from the sump. I think this is in our daily domestic also, we see the same thing. The water is being taken from the well or from your sump and to the overhead tank. Now, the suction head and discharge head and all those things are listed. It's a very, very simple, fundamental diagram for us to understand the centrifugal pump. So, I just move on here. Unless you have any issue. Now, let us clarify this point. I just mentioned it earlier. Net positive suction head. Now, what is it? Available and required. And we always say the available has to be more than the required.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it? So, the minimum pressure required at the suction port of the pump to keep the pump from cavitating. Now, can you tell me what is cavitation, gentlemen? I just want one of the students to tell me. What is cavitation?
Formation.
And we are always worried about cavitation. What are the symptoms about cavitation?
Noise, vibration.
So, how does it cavitate? Cavitation means, now, how will you explain cavitation in simple terms? Let's not go to that formula, garmula and all. Just simple terms. How it happens?
When the fluid pressure drops more than a water pressure. When the fluid pressure
tell me,
drops
more than...
When the fluid
please,
pressure
little
drops,
louder, please.
Sir, when fluid pressure drops below the vapor pressure, the cavitation will happen, sir.
But cavitation, how does it occur? You mean to say at the eye of the impeller? See, there is a pressure. See, at the eye of the impeller, centrifugal pump impeller, there is some pressure. Suppose on the suction side, if you throttle or if you close anything, that pressure variation is going to occur. And every fluid has got some vapor pressure. Now, like for example, vapor pressure, you will not be able to change. Like between diesel oil and fuel oil, which has got a higher vapor pressure? Diesel oil or fuel oil?
Diesel oil.
Diesel oil, sir.
Diesel oil. Or in other words, what we can say, your vapor pressure relates to volatility. If it is more volatile, like for example, if you take between petrol and diesel, which is more volatile?
Petrol.
So petrol will have a higher vapor pressure. So every liquid has got, so whichever liquid, whichever fluid centrifugal pump is treating, due to some throttling or closing, if any such thing happens, at the eye of the impeller, when the liquid comes, if the pressure there happens to be less than the vapor pressure of the particular liquid, then what happens? Immediately, vaporization takes place. Because your boiling point keeps varying. You know, we have seen it in freshwater generator. The water boils at 43 degrees or 45 degrees. It's not at 100 degrees. So, then what happens? The vapor liquid flow is going to continue through the guide vanes of the centrifugal pump from the eye of the impeller to the periphery. So, that means what? From low pressure side to high pressure when it is traveling, please remember, the bubbles what you get is the liquid, the bubbles or the evaporated or the vapors of the same liquid. Because sometimes some people tell me, no, sir, air is entering. No, it's not there. It's a vapor bubble of that particular liquid. Because why it has happened? Because of boiling. Now, where that travels through the guide vane from the low pressure zone to the high pressure zone, at high pressure zone, the vapor bubbles, what do we say always? Erodes. It just blasts, So, at that point of time, it causes some erosion. That's what basically the cavitation is all about. So, the NPSH part of it, we always need... some of you, if you are working in a, gas tankers, In gas tanker cargo pumps, do you remember? In we have the DPL pumps, and then at the entry point where you have a suction bell mouth, in a gas tanker cargo pump I am talking about, the pump is located inside the cargo tank, and at the suction bell mouth, when the liquefied gas enters, the first thing before the impeller, you got something what we call inducer. All of you are with me? You heard about it, inducer?
Sir. No, yes, sir.
No?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. Sir. Some of you, probably if you have sailed in a gas tanker, you know. Or okay, what I do, maybe end of the session when I come to one slide on gas tanker, there I will show you the inducer and I will explain. In fact, why I asked suddenly about inducer, now inducer is the basic, specifically, you know, it is not given in a Framo pump. It is not given in your COP in a tanker. Inducer is not given in your fire and GS pump or your ballast pump. Now, why is it given only in gas tanker cargo pump? Because the liquefied gas, you have the vulnerability of turning into vapor at the first opportunity, because basically it is a liquefied gas, you know, waiting to turn into vapor. So what happens is, at the entry point, you know, to minimize the suction losses or to keep your NPSH requirement low, the inducer design helps. That's what the experts say. But anyhow, when we come to the gas tanker, I will just show you that, you know, I have a schematic diagram and an actual photograph of an inducer. We will discuss about it. Okay, from NPSH, we will just now come to, yes, this is your net positive suction head. Now here, I just want to explain the requirement, you know, NPSH requirement. And NPSH required is given by the pump manufacturer. We always say that. Pump manufacturer, if you see your pump manual, it is given. And as you can see here, the available, what is this? This is your, if it is a tank like this, it is atmospheric pressure. As you can see, you know, HSP, what is it? Atmospheric pressure. But whereas if you see like this, now this is what is happening in a oil tanker. Now oil tanker, now this is your cargo pump. This is a cargo tank. Now what do you have? Tank pressure right on top, what do you have? You have in-gas pressure, remember? IG pressure. So you will have, if it is an oil tanker, you are in the pump room, your cargo pump is like this, and of course your tank is, liquid level is up to this, and above the liquid volume, what you have? Inert gas. Your inert gas, you may have, oh, say, 600 millimeter water gauge. Generally, we have, you know, 600, 800. So now, in addition to the atmospheric pressure, that is going to give a push to the liquid, pushing it to the eye of the impeller. This, I'm talking about an oil tanker. Now, suppose if a pump is like this. Here, it is not suction head. What do we call it? Suction lift. So, when you have a suction lift, you have a problem. Now, how much suction lift you can have? Now, here is not an issue. The moment you open the valve, by gravity, because of the head, it's a suction head, that liquid will automatically flow into the pump casing. So, not a problem at all. But then we have issue here. Now the pump is at a higher level than the liquid level. Now this is where we need to worry about your NPSH required. Like for example, I'll come back to this diagram. Now look at this. This is a hand-drawn diagram by me. Are you able to see this diagram, gentlemen? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, now see, I'm just asking you a question. Now this is a container and you have liquid. So much of liquid you have. Let us assume it's water. You have water so much and I have a centrifugal pump. Now this is the pump. Now, the pump has got a flexible suction hose and this is a discharge pipe. Now, the pump is running and when the pump is running, now the pump is having suction head or suction lift?
Suction head.
Suction head.
Suction head. Suction head,
suction head, because the liquid level is higher than the eye of the impeller. So, because of the suction head, there is no problem. So, you can see here now water is coming. But then what I do, I slowly lift this pump from this level to this level. See, I just slowly lift the pump like this. Then what will happen? It will go like this. But I find still water is coming. So as and when I keep on lifting it, now this, you come to this diagram now. Now what I have done, I am now lifting this pump. Now the pump is at a height. Now this is... now, what do we call it? This is your suction lift now. Now, the water level is here. Eye of the impeller is here. So, still the water is coming. Now, if I keep on in lifting further and further higher than the water level, will it keep on discharging or at one point of time it will stop?
It will stop at one point.
So, for very easy understanding, you just measure that height. When it loses suction, that gives you an idea about net positive suction head required. Now, that is the required suction, net positive suction head you need to have. You get an idea now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sir, now, let's look at some of the pumps. Now, this pump is... what's your doubt?
Sir, suppose in the
framework... Somebody said doubt. I mean, please tell me your name, please.
Yes, sir. It's Karthik, sir.
Karthik, go ahead.
Sir, suppose in a Framo pump, there is only of a suction head nozzle. There is no suction lift nozzle.
Yes, you are very correct. In a Framo pump, we call it submerged pump. And, you know, there... till the tank is empty, because your cargo tank also will have a, because of the double bottom, you can afford to have a suction well. Since you have a suction well, you locate your Framo pump, you know, in the well, so that what will happen, all the time, till the tank is empty, by the time the pump loses suction, when the pump loses suction, you can be rest assured that the tank is empty and a little bit of liquid is there in the suction well, below the suction bell mouth of your Framo pump. That means throughout it, you'll have only suction head. Yeah, you are right. What is your question?
Sir, same thing, sir. Right.
No, there the question of, I mean, your NPSH required doesn't come because it is not a suction lift at all. It is suction head, no?
Yes, sir. Right, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
See? Right. You understood?
Yes, I am done. Thank you, sir.
Framo pump, that is why Framo pump is preferred, you know. Nowadays, you know, you will find, apart from chemical, Framo pump, where we use, we use it in chemical tankers and we use in petroleum product tankers. And of course, nowadays, the Framo pump manufacturers, what do they recommend? They say even in your crude oil tankers, you can have. But I sailed on VLCCs, but then we never had. There we had COP driven by a turbine, COPT. But then, that's the advantage of your, Framo. See, likewise in gas tanker. In gas tankers, very popular pump manufacturer is Sonnehose. The Sonnehose pump maker. See, there we have, what we call deep well. There again, you keep it right down. So, as long as the pump is having all the time head, suction head, then nothing to worry about it. Here, I'm talking about when you have a pump in the pump room in a tanker and the cargo level in the cargo tank is going below the pump level, that's where you're going to have this problem. Is it okay, Karthik?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Mr. Shekhar, sir.
Yes. Sorry for yes, moderator here.
There were three questions raised by candidates. From Mr. Yes. Venkateshwaran, is there any net positive discharge head? That's the question raised from him.
No, it is only net positive suction. See, suction side only we are more worried, so that the pump should not lose suction. Because the suction side only you will have problems. Discharge side, it's only the head, designed head, the pump should be able to lift. Anyhow, I'll come to the performance curve, then, there we will be able to talk more about it. So, there is nothing, we have only net positive suction head. Discharge side, what is going to happen is there is going to be friction head. There is going to be, you take your fire and GS pump. Now, GS pump is located in the engine room. And where is the hydrant? The hydrant is going to be, let me assume the hydrant is in the bridge wing, right on top. That means the pump must be capable of taking the liquid all the way from the engine room right up to the bridge wing. You just think about the vertical height. So, what is going to happen? If you open the hydrant, next to the pump, look at the flow rate. And what will happen when the liquid is being discharged at that rate at the higher level? So, there, that's the issues we have on the discharge side. Otherwise, there is no net positive discharge head as such. What is the next question, moderator?
Our next question raised from Mr. Stalin Raj. Difference between ejector and eductor?
Eductor and ejector both are same here. Because on board, we use both the term. Then, what is the third question?
Third question raised from Mr. Girish Krishnan. He need a clarification about P2 is less than P1.
P2 is less than P1. That means, you need to look at, basically, you have studied Bernoulli's theorem long time back in your physics.
Yes, sir.
So, you just check it out again Bernoulli's theorem, because I don't have time to explain here because there are a lot of other slides I have to go. Basically, if you just look at this, this is what I was just talking about. Now you are talking, you are asking me why P2 is less than P1. Is that your question? Hello? I think that is your question. That is the basic, you know. If you just look at your basic, you know, what we call Bernoulli's theorem, if you just, you know, study it once again, if I mean, then and probably in my next class, you can ask me. Because here, if you just see, P1, the P2 has to be less than P1. And what is happening? V2 is going to be, the velocity is going to be more than V1. Or what do we call it? P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. So you just look at the basics of fundamental, you know, what we call thermodynamic laws, like, you know, PV is equal to NRT. P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. If you go to the basics and if you just study that, then you will understand. Okay. Okay, now here, and the capacities of centrifugal pump, I already mentioned it. In bigger ships, you have 5,000, 6,000. Now here you can see the capacity. 15,000 cubic meter per hour, and the total head is so much, and pump speed is generally this much. Okay, now this is, here it is actually, you can say, double entry. Now see, this is the suction side. Entry is at the top as well as entry at the bottom. And the darker green shade, that is what is the discharge side. Okay. Now, of course, this has got advantages when you have, instead of single entry, we call it a double entry pump. So this is basic, basically. Of course, if you look at the materials, what are the various materials you will find? Like, for example, Framo pump, if you look at Framo pump, all materials are stainless steel shaft, and you just think about anything, everything, except your seals, the cargo seals in Framo pump. And both cofferdam seal as well as cargo seals, both are Teflon, what we call PTFE, polytetrafluoroethylene. Otherwise, you know, the materials, I think it is very basics. All of you know that, so I move on. So this is how, this is the oil tanker, you know, cargo pump. And now, if you see the, these are the, just for you to have an idea, you see. This I have taken from Shinko. Shinko is very popular in tankers, you know, oil tankers. Now, if you see here, capacity ranges from 1,000 cubic meters to almost 6,000 cubic meters. And you see the head from 120 to 150. And your RPM range is 1,800 to 1,100. So one thing you will note is as the capacity increases, you see it is running at 1,100, 1,200. And of course, the weight of the pump, you just see here it is about 1 ton, 1 point. And here it is about, say, 3.8 tons. You know. Okay, gentlemen, let me ask you. You will always find pumps like your ballast pump or your COPs, always they have double volume. Now, do you understand what is double volume? Now, earlier in the diagram, what I have shown you, that is a single volume. Now, what is the difference between single volume and double volume? And for MEO examination candidates, I would like to remind you a couple of times this question has been asked. Can anyone tell me what is a double volume casing?
It is just an arrangement to nullify the radial thrust on the impeller. Yes. Normally, in single volute casing, it will be there. On the discharge side, yes, there will be excess thrust. In order to nullify this, they will put a ring on the discharge side so that the area will be reduced and then radial thrust will be nullified.
Yes. I'll show you a schematic diagram, you know, for others if you don't understand. Because, see, what happens in a centrifugal pump, you know, at the eye of the impeller, the liquid enters and then, you know, it just changes direction. In the process, it creates an axial thrust. No, that's why you see we have, thrust bearings also. So, in a smaller capacity centrifugal pump, it's not a big issue. But what will happen if you, like your COPs of 5,000 cubics and 3,000 cubics and all that, what is going to happen? This axial thrust is going to be to a higher value, which is not, it is going to be detrimental because it's going to, give a lateral thrust on the shaft tending to bend the shaft. So what they use, generally you will find this in COPs and of course your ballast pumps. You know, very often in bigger capacity, you know, I'm talking about bigger ships, you will find your ballast pump capacity is also very high. And let us just understand, let me move and look at this slide and then study. If you have any question, ask me. Now, what does this double volute casing, what does it do? To balance radial thrust on volute casing pumps, a double volute is installed instead of a single volute. And you see the diagram. You see here, this is a single volume and this is a double volume. Now, double volume, if you just look at the graph on the, there is a graph there between radial thrust and flow. Can you see that? And see the difference, how the graph of the double volume. Double volume, as you can see here, it is right at the bottom here, see, double volume. So suppose if this is the design point or this is the rated flow rate for the centrifugal pump, you are going to see if you have a double volume, the radial thrust is only this much. But if it is going to be a single volume, it's going to be so high. So which is higher? Single volume casing, if you have, it's going to be detrimental. The radial thrust is more. Have you understood, gentlemen?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Is it understood? Can I go to the next slide?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, this is a very important thing. I just want you to just see how a performance curve is drawn. I just hand-drawn it. Just to explain, let me just explain you like this. Now, let us say, now this is the pump, CP, centrifugal pump. Now, here is the pump. And the liquid enters at this point like this. And let us say, your discharge pipe is at the same level. That means your head is zero. If head is zero, then when the centrifugal pump is running, taking liquid from the suction pipe and then discharging here, then what is going to be the flow rate? Now the flow rate is going to be the maximum flow rate. Am I right? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now what I have done here, I am keeping a vertical pipe. You see, now just assume this is a vertical pipe. I am keeping a vertical pipe open on top and there is a valve there. Now what I am going to do is, I am going to close this valve. Now this valve is closed. Now what will happen? I am not doing anything to the pump. The pump is running. Pump is running. Earlier, when the valve was open, the liquid was flowing in the horizontal direction. But now what I have done, I have closed the valve and I am allowing the liquid. Now what will happen to the liquid? Will it rise in the vertical pipe? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, the liquid will rise all the way. Let us assume it goes up to this. It depends upon the capacity of the pump. If it is a 5 HP or if it is a 3 HP, depending upon the capacity of the pump, it may come up to this level or it may go to this level or it may come to this level. I'm assuming now this is a level it has reached. Now, the valve is closed and the pump is running. What will happen now? This is now churning will occur. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Now, churning is going to occur. Now, the point is, now at this point, the liquid, this is what we call it head. You see? Now, MLC means what? Meter, liquid, column. Now, this is how we develop the performance curve of a centrifugal pump. Now, this valve is closed. Now, the liquid here, liquid is up to this point. Now, the pump is okay, churning. Now, assume that to visualize, now there is this dotted line is a, assume it is a pipe. Now, if you have a valve here, you have a valve. And this valve, what you are doing now, you are opening. Then what will happen? The liquid will not go to this pipe. Now, the earlier the liquid level was here, the moment you open this valve, what will happen? The liquid is going to flow in this through this pipe. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, sir. You are right.
Yes, sir. Right.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
so,
yes, sir.
Now, what is going to be the flow rate? Now, that means the liquid is lifted to this head through the up to this height, and then the liquid is flowing at a slower rate. But the moment you open this valve at this head, then what will happen? I am opening this and I am closing this. Now what will happen? Now the flow rate will increase. Will it increase or decrease?
It will increase.
So now what I have done, now at this head, what is the flow rate? Now this much is the flow rate. Now you just see, now here I have just drawn with an arrow. Q is what? Cubic meter per hour. Now this is the flow rate. Now here there is a zero flow rate because head is maximum, flow rate is zero. Whereas at this head, what is the flow rate? Flow rate is here. This is the flow rate. If I come all the way right down, now this is the flow rate at that head. As you can see, when the head reduces, the flow rate is increasing. Whereas when I open this, the flow rate comes here. And if I open this valve again, then what will happen? Maximum flow rate.
Maximum.
These flow rate points I note down here, and I connect all these points. Now, this is what I call what? HQ curve. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So, now this is how your QH curve is drawn. Okay. Now, what I have written here? 1000 RPM. Now, as long as the pump is 1000 RPM, it is like this. Now, suppose I reduce the pump RPM to 800 RPM. Then what will happen to the curve? What will happen?
Curve will shift down.
It will be at the same, the graph will be same.
Shift down.
Shift down, yes. Now, at 800 RPM, it's going to be parallel to this. Now, this is your 800. Understood? Now, likewise, if the RPM is 1200, you are going to have a parallel line going up or going down.
Going up.
Understood?
Going up, sir.
Yeah. If it is 1200, it will go. See, if the RPM is more, then it will go. And if the RPM is less. Now, let me ask you one more question. Now the liquid which this pump was dealing, let us say the liquid was diesel oil. Now, diesel oil with a specific gravity of, let me tell you, 0.89. Okay. Now, instead of diesel oil, I am having, let us say, fuel oil. Now, I am just changing the diesel oil. Instead of diesel oil, now the centrifugal pump is handling fuel oil. Now, the fuel oil is a heated fuel oil. Now, let us say the fuel oil temperature is about 60 degrees centigrade. Now, at that point of time, what will happen? Will it, when it is diesel oil, when I close this valve, it came up to this level. Now, if it is fuel oil, again, with the pump running at the same RPM, when I close this valve, the fuel oil will come higher level or lower level or same
lower
level. What do you think?
Lower level.
Depend on viscosity.
I'm not talking about viscosity because I'm telling you the oil is heated.
Same.
Oil is heated.
Higher level.
Lower level. Okay, gentlemen, my young friends, please, and I mean, look at the pump basics. You will find the head is same. Whether it is fuel oil or whether it is diesel oil or whether it is water, as long as the capacity of the pump is same,
the head will be same.
The head is, but one thing, what will happen with the valve closed? Suppose if I put a pressure gauge here, let us say I put a pressure gauge, and then this pressure gauge, what will happen? If it is diesel oil, it is going to show a different reading. And if it is fuel oil, this pressure, I am talking about the pressure here, that is going to vary. Because why? Because pressure is what? We always use the formula, you remember, rho g h. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, sir.
What is rho here? Your g and h is same. You know, your h is constant now because I told you already, fuel oil, diesel oil or any liquid that you have, whatever may be the density variation, the head is same. So, your rho, I mean, g is also same. So, that means the pressure is proportional to rho. That means accordingly, what will happen? The pressure here may vary, but otherwise, it's going to be the same. Now, this one thing I want the young friends to understand. And also, I want you to just look at this NPSH curve here. Can you see this NPSH curve? Now, this NPSH curve, this is required. The curve will always, you know, your NPSH curve will be like this. You see this curve? Can you look at NPSH required, curve D?
Yes, sir.
What is curve A is your HQ, I mean the QH curve, what we have drawn. And curve D, this is what is your curve. So now what is going to happen? There is always something what we call static head. What is this static head? Like for example, let us look at oil tanker. Now oil tanker, your cargo pump, where is the cargo pump? In the pump room, right at the bottom. Bottom of the pump room, you have your cargo pump, COP. And this pump is lifting the cargo to the manifold on the deck. Now, that means the height between the pump and the manifold on the deck, that vertical height, it's going to be same, no? Whichever port you go for discharging, am I right?
Yes, sir.
So, that, I mean, whichever port you go for discharging, that head is, I mean, that vertical height is going to be same. That means the pump is required to deliver a particular designed flow rate at the manifold. At the manifold is going to be the same. But what will happen beyond the manifold when chicken is connected or loading arm is connected, based on the conditions in that particular port, the discharge rate at the shore tank will vary. Now, this is what we call static head. So, at the static head, like for example, suppose if this is the static head, now let us say this is your static head. This should be a vertical line. I should have drawn it like this. Okay, straight. Okay, now suppose if this is the static head, now whatever it intersects with the HU curve, now this is what we call, we use a term, this is called design point, you know. Now, this your pump is designed to deliver that much of flow rate at that particular head. This is how it is designed. But what will happen now? Suppose, depending upon the port, what may happen is your shore curve or the back pressure curve may vary either like this or like this. Like this. Now, suppose this is a very shallow curve. That means the back pressure is low. That means this is the ideal flow rate that you are supposed to get at the manifold. Suppose once the loading arm is connected, you are going to get a flow rate like this, only this much. You see the reduction. So the flow rate is reduced by this much. But if it is a very, very steep, if your back pressure or the shore curve, what we call, then what is going to happen? Where is the intersection point? Here. Now that means the flow rate will be only this much. So this is what will happen at the discharge side of the pump. So gentlemen, now these are the main characteristics of centrifugal pump. You can just look quickly, you can just go through. Now this is what it is, efficiency curve. And I think we have already seen it, so that I'll just go to the next slide. Okay. So if RPM varies, as you can see already, I have explained it. Parallel operation and series operation in the graph, you have just seen it. Now overall, it's the same thing. What I've shown, it's the same thing. No? QH curve and all, I already explained. And if you have parallel operation, this is what it is. Okay. Now, gentlemen, this is very, very important. I would like to just, look at it. All of you have your remaining in lube oil pump is what, centrifugal pump, or any of you have screw pump? Hello, I would like to.
Centrifugal pump. Centrifugal pump. Vertical centrifugal pump.
Oh, okay. All of you. Anybody had a screw pump? Anybody had screw pump? No?
Yes, sir.
Achha, some of you had screw pump, huh?
For cargo discharging, sir.
Cargo discharging is okay. No, I'm talking about your main engine lube oil pump.
No.
Okay. See, what I want to share with you is, now this is the centrifugal pump QH curve. You know, you see this. This is what it is. But whereas if you see your positive display, if you use the screw pump for main engine lube oil pump duty, then look at this. This is the QH curve. The QH curve for the positive displacement pump or screw pump is going to be something like this. So suppose if the oil is cold, that means when you start your, you are on standby and you just started your main engine lube oil pump and you are in port, you are about to sail maybe after a couple of hours. So what will you do? You'll start your main engine lube oil pump. So when you do that, system characteristic for the cold oil, you can see the cold oil. Now the cold oil, now the flow rate is going to be how much? The flow rate is, this is the flow rate. Flow rate means what? This is the quantum of oil that is flowing in the pipeline to your bearings for piston cooling and coming back to the sump. Now this is the flow rate. And if it is a positive displacement also, he is taking it. This is just for comparison. Whereas when the oil becomes warm, then what will happen when the engine starts running hot oil? The oil turns into whatever is your main engine lube oil pump, you know, maybe 45 degrees, let us say. So that means from cold oil, when it becomes hot oil, now what happens? Your frictional resistance is reduced. So you will find now the flow rate that goes to your bearings, that oil that goes to your piston cooling and your main bearing, all those things, now the flow rate has increased. Now that is why here you see centrifugal quantum increase. This is the advantage what you get in centrifugal pump. And if you look at the same thing with the positive displacement pump, you see the increment. Increment is so less. Positive displacement pump, Q increase is only this much. Whereas in a centrifugal pump, you will find the Q increase is more. That is why nowadays you will find most of the ships, we have centrifugal pump for reduce the, at the same time, what is happening to the pressure drop? You see, centrifugal pump resultant pressure drop is only from here to here. You see, the drop in head, earlier the head was up to this. Now the head is up to this. Now how much is the pressure drop in centrifugal pump? Very less. Whereas in the case of a positive displacement pump, you see the pressure drop is so much from here to here. So now, which is, advantages for us to have?
Centrifugal pump.
Yeah. And biggest another advantage is, you must have seen your main engine lube oil pump is always inside the lube oil sump, right at the bottom. So that means what does it do? Always your lube oil sump, the minimum lube oil we are maintaining. That means the pump is always will have positive suction head, which is a pre-requirement, So this, I just wanted to highlight this issue. Okay, gentlemen, now...